Hello anatomy friends, this is Dr. Alsup, and in this video we will be discussing the anatomical considerations regarding inguinal hernias. With our major goal of being able to anatomically differentiate between an indirect and a direct hernia, so the two major types of inguinal hernias. So what even is an inguinal hernia? So inguinal hernias are protrusions or herniations of both parietal peritoneum and often viscera, such as portions of the small intestine, through a normal or an abnormal opening in the inguinal region. An inguinal hernia is the most common type of hernia in the abdominal region. So other types of abdominal hernias include umbilical hernias, which, as the name would suggest, involve the umbilical region. You can also have incisional hernias, so a hernia caused by a surgical incision. And even femoral hernias are often considered in the abdominal region, as they are near but certainly inferior to the inguinal region. So these are often lumped or considered as portions or types of abdominal hernias, but inguinal hernias are going to be the most common. There are two types of inguinal hernias. There are indirect and direct, and these are often difficult to differentiate in terms of a clinical exam. Both types of inguinal hernias can happen to any individual, but are more common in individuals with spermatic cords and testes due to the relatively larger size of the inguinal canals with the descent of the testes into the scrotum. So ovaries do not traverse the inguinal canal, whereas the testes do, so there's a relatively larger size there. Okay, so let's talk about the differences between these types of inguinal hernias. First, we will start with just overall frequency. And indirect hernias are more common. About two-thirds of inguinal hernias are indirect inguinal hernias. So easy enough, we got that one down. All right, now we get into some of the fun stuff. Both indirect and direct hernias will protrude and sometimes travel through the inguinal canal. All right, so both are going to have some role in terms of that inguinal canal that we've talked about. Now, how they get there differs. Remember this, friend, the lateral umbilical fold that we've talked about in other videos? It's that fold that's formed by peritoneum covering the inferior epigastric vessels. Well, a direct inguinal hernia will enter the canal medial to the inferior epigastric vessels, so a direct would be medial, whereas an indirect will enter lateral to both the inferior epigastric vessels, and of course the lateral umbilical fold is created by peritoneum lying over those structures. So direct will always be medial, and indirect will always be lateral. So to be more specific, recall that the deep inguinal ring, or that entryway to the inguinal canal, is just lateral to the inferior epigastric vasculature. So an indirect inguinal herniation will enter the inguinal canal through the deep inguinal ring. Okay, that is an important difference here. So it will go through that deep inguinal ring and often will traverse the entire inguinal canal and sometimes beyond the inguinal canal. A direct inguinal herniation I always think of as not having time to go through an already existing entryway. It is more direct. It just kind of pushes its way through into the inguinal canal through an area of weak fascia in the inguinal triangle. All right, so over here, lateral, we'll have that indirect. The direct is going kind of straight through some of that weak fascia in the inguinal triangle. Recall that inguinal triangle is bounded by the inferior epigastric vasculature superolaterally, the inguinal ligament down here inferiorly, and the rectus abdominis muscle more medially. So that is that inguinal triangle. Sometimes you hear it referred to as the triangle of Hasselbeck. Now, as mentioned, inguinal hernias can happen in any individual, but are more common in individuals with spermatic cords and testes due to that relatively larger size based on the descent of the testes to the scrotum. And with this, there is the possibility that the herniation can extend past the inguinal canal all the way to the scrotum. This is pretty rare in terms of direct inguinal hernias, but are possible with indirect inguinal hernias, particularly in individuals with what is referred to as a patent processus vaginalis. So this processus vaginalis is a naturally occurring structure in utero. It's an extension of peritoneum that traverses the inguinal canal to the scrotum during development, and it will precede the descent of the testes. Now, what happens right around birth is that proximal portion of the processus vaginalis will occlude or close with a persistent portion surrounding the testes. But the point is that that pathway between the peritoneal cavity and the scrotum is closed typically. Those with a patent or open or persistent processus vaginalis would allow an easier pathway for herniation contents to descend from the peritoneal cavity as far as that tunica vaginalis of the testes in the scrotum. Sometimes you hear that pathway of an indirect hernia is comparable to the pathway followed during the descent of the testes. Now, sometimes you hear the indirect inguinal hernia is being referred to as congenital, and processus vaginalis, or the persistent one, that's what it's referring to, the fact that the processus vaginalis did not become occluded at birth, thus predisposing to that type of herniation to occur. Indirect inguinal hernias can be congenital, as we just mentioned, but they can also be acquired as well and caused by weakened fascia around the deep inguinal ring. And in examples of, say, like straining with heavy and unstable lifting, that can cause herniation through the deep inguinal ring, sometimes can cause the expansion or change in shape of the deep inguinal ring. Direct inguinal hernias are always caused by an acquired weakness of the posterior wall of the inguinal canal, specifically that within that inguinal triangle region that we discussed previously. Excellent. So I have put this information in a handy dandy chart, easy to read chart that you can find here in your summary slide. Please review this information and reach out to me or any of my anatomy colleagues regarding remaining questions. Thank you for your time and attention, and I hope you have a great rest of your day.